How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
How sweet the name of Good morning, St. Paul Church family and friends. We are excited to be in the house of the Lord today. Wherever you are, come into his presence and begin to plan to worship him today. Let us give God a hand clap of praise. Oh, that's a little weak. Let's get a little stronger. Praise the Lord wherever you are. Amen. God is good, and let us prepare our hearts to come before him and come into his presence. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful. We're so grateful. We're so elated that we can come before you today, that we have come again this week to worship and praise your holy name. Lord, we ask that you would be in the midst of all that is done today, that it will be pleasing and acceptable to you. Lord, this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, and the song of praise will be given by Brother Jerron Grandstaff. Our prayer will be led by Brother Chris Nelson. And our scripture will be given by Brother Jerron Grandstaff. Let's just change that song of praise because I see a few people coming forward. So we're going to have a little praise team going on here. So prepare your hearts. Get ready, get ready, get ready.
Bless his name this morning. Amen. All right, that same excitement our first lady had, it's going to carry over to you out there as it has to us in here. Amen. He is Jireh, and he is enough, no matter what you're going through. And we thank you, God, for that. Thank you for being a provider.
I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up. So there's nothing I can do to let you down. Doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice.
Cross an ocean so I wouldn't drown.
You've never been closer than you are right now.
You are Jireh. You are enough. Jireh. You are enough.
Chosen. I know who I am.
I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved more than I could imagine. What you've spoken, I'm already loved more than I could imagine, and that is enough.
I'm already loved,
I'm already chosen, I know who I am, I know what you've spoken.
His name. Thank you, God. You are enough. Bless your name, oh God.
Dear Father, I come to you today and just thanking you for waking everybody up on this beautiful Sunday morning, Lord. I also come to you just asking for healing, Lord, because through this whole pandemic, Lord, we all need healing. For those families that lost anybody to COVID, so sickness to cancer, Lord, I just ask you to just heal, put your arms around them and get them through this difficult time, Lord. And Lord, I pray for everyone that is in Texas, Lord, that is dealing with this bad weather, Lord. Lord, I ask you to just get them through that, keep them strong, protect those families, protect those young ones. And then I come again to you, Lord, just to touch our pastor, our first lady, give them the power and the strength to also get through this whole pandemic. Touch our pastor's heart, Lord, mind, so we can deliver a powerful message. And Lord, I just hope one day that we can all come in and walk in to the beautiful St. Paul hallways and just see all my church members one of these days, Lord. And I come to you in Jesus' name, I pray, amen.
Good morning. I'll be reading Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. That's Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the ninth hour, the hour of prayer. And a certain man, who from birth had no power in his legs, was taken there every day and put down at the door of the temple, which is named Beautiful, requesting money from those who went in the temple. He then, seeing Peter and John going into the temple, made a request to them. And Peter, looking at him with John, said, "Keep your eyes on us." And he gave attention to them, hoping to get something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver or gold, but what I have that I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up on your feet." And he took him by his right hand, lifting him up, and straight away his feet and the bones of his legs became strong. And jumping up, he got onto his feet and went into the temple with them, walking and jumping and giving praise to God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. And they saw that it was the man who made requests for money at the door of the temple. And they were full of wonder and surprise at what had taken place. Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen. I'm still humming that. Jireh, you are now. I tell you, I was getting into that. Y'all ended that too soon. Amen. I hope you at home were getting into that as well. It was wonderful. Thank you so much. I just want to remind you that we have a church conference scheduled next Sunday, immediately after service. We will also be celebrating our Founders Day celebration. The other thing is that if you're not aware, let me explain to you. This is Black History Month. And take a little time to think about the history and the heritage that we have for African Americans. And in that spirit, there is a African American cultural display of African Americans in the Shenandoah Valley at the Museum of the Shenandoah Valley. And I ask that you go out there and take a look at that, because some of those people may be descendants of yours. And also, it gives you a little bit more information about the history here in this area that you may not be aware of. So go out there and support that display. This month or next month, I'm not sure how long it's going to be out there, but get out there as soon as you can. And let me just give you this little tidbit, is that on Wednesdays, it is free. Free? I did say free. So there is no fee. So go out there and you don't have an excuse, because you got a day that's free. I think they do close a little early during the winter months. So my understanding is they close at 4 o'clock. So be prepared and just go out there and support that. I think I'm going to go out there and visit today. So anybody want to join me? Come on. Thank you.
Amen. Hey, look, you know that God is great, right? Amen. You've heard me say it many times. He's awesome. He's amazing. He is everything to me. I know he's everything to you as well. And we bless him and praise his holy name. He is our God. He's our Father. He loves us. Man, you don't know how much he loves. His love is just, you can't even calculate the love that God has for us. And I'm so grateful that he loves me that much. And you may not feel love, but you are loved by God. I know that for myself. Bless his holy name. We're going to take a moment. We try to do this every month to celebrate those who've had anniversaries, who've had birthdays. So we're going to do that right now. As I'm looking at my information, looks like on the 27th of this month, Paul and Charlotte Washington will celebrate their anniversary. Praise the Lord. Let's give God a hand of praise. It's coming. It's coming, and we're going to ask either Sister Shields or Brother Jeffrey to come and sing him a little song, if you will. Amen.
Happy anniversary to you, happy anniversary to you, happy anniversary to all the names that Pastor said, happy anniversary.
Thank you for that, Brother Jeffrey. I think y'all feel that you've been celebrated. I know that's the truth, right? Listen, we have some birthdays. Now, you might want to get out your pen because some of these people, you want to remember their birthday and you know, send them a little card or something, something. You know what I mean? I know you do. The first one is Peggy Nelson. Her birthday was on the 8th of February. Marvin Scott was on the 8th, and Ursula Williams on the 8th as well. On the 10th was Evangelist Karen Wiles. She's in here today. Ukiah Walker was on the 14th. Carlotta Carey was on the 16th. Angel Rose on the 17th. And on the 21st, which is tomorrow, is Kathy Long's birthday. And then Doris Thompson on the 23rd. Brian Gunn on the 26th. And Sheila Brown on the 28th, that last day of the month of February. And with that list being shared, someone's going to come and help us out again.
Amen, amen. Happy birthday to y'all. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday.
I'll pray. I have to pray on that one. Amen. We have celebrated y'all today. If your birthday is already passed, you ought to give God praise because you made it again. I don't know about you, but I find that to be a blessing from God every time I get to celebrate that day. I give him praise for that. So take a moment. If you forgot to do it on that day, you're busy taking care of other things, thank him that you made it. All right? That's the grace of God on your life. I know that's the truth. Last but not least, I need to reiterate that next Sunday, after the worship service, we will have a church conference. But before the church conference, we'll celebrate our founding. We'll have a special guest preacher next week. Reverend Norman Vick will be our guest preacher. Make sure you're here to hear a message and a word from God. I know God is going to bless you. And also, it'll be a time to think about the founding of this awesome church that we belong to. Be ready. God is always ready. Bless you.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor, for allowing me to just announce that it is not too late to drop off your winter coats, your winter clothes, your shoes, your boots, canned goods for all ages, all shapes and sizes. Today from 1 to 2:30, we'll be here at the church to accept your donations. And let me say thank you, thank you, thank you to all those who have already donated. Your generosity is just overwhelming sometimes. I'm so blessed by the generosity that you show to others. I just want you to know, I can't name everybody by name because if I forget one, then it'll be my bad. So you know who you are, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart along with the YPD. You can still choose to donate. Just one coat is sufficient. We'll be here from 1 o'clock at the back of the church. Thank you.
Get a twisted man. can shoot me with your words. You can cut me with your lies. You can kill me with your hatefulness. But just like life, I'll rise.
Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, we'll be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spirit. Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Praise God. We want to thank God for that awesome presentation. A blessing from God, definitely. I want to also thank the young adult ministry for being involved and engaged in ministry today. We love our young adults. We believe that God wants to use them, and he did today, and I know he's going to do that in the future. Continue to pray for them as they use their gifts for God. I'm going to invite you to turn in your Bible to the book of Acts chapter 3, and we'll read a portion of that third chapter. We're looking at, I'm calling, for lack of a term right now, before you enter the sanctuary is what I'm calling it, okay? All right, so Acts chapter 3, I'm going to read for you. I'm going to work through the whole passage, but I want to focus your attention on verse 5. I'm reading out of the new. You'll hear the translation be a little different, so you'll notice that. It says in verse 5, the lame man looked at them, eagerly expecting some money. But Peter said, I don't have any silver or gold for you, but I'll give you what I have. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, get up and walk. Amen, said the preacher. There's so much in that verse. We'll get to that in a moment. But before you enter the sanctuary, it's where I'm going today, and then we'll talk about that. But let's first talk to God. Father, we thank you for this moment you've given us to share out of your word. I pray that you will do your work first in me, and then work in all of us together as we share in this moment. We need the Holy Spirit. We need the anointing that he can give and that he can bring. And I pray in Jesus' name that he will do that across every platform, even in the sanctuary right now. And God, we always need you to help us. And so we pray in Jesus' name that the help we need will come right now in manifestation for the glory of Christ. And we are ready to receive it. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, look, you probably heard this, but I'm going to say it because I think it needs to be said, and that is that many pastors are wondering what's going to happen when the doors open up. They are. They're wondering. They're wondering, are you coming back? Are you coming? I heard a person say not too long ago that it's good at home. Being at home is, well, you can be lazy, you can lay around, you don't have to get dressed, you don't have to get the kids ready. Some mama say amen to that, right? You don't have to go through all the trepidation and the challenges that come with trying to get ready for church. Right? Right? And so we as pastors understand that it's kind of sweet at home on Facebook, YouTube, and live streaming, right? It's kind of sweet. But I want you to hear something today that I pray you're willing to listen to. That is this: as sweet as it is where you're sitting or lying right now, there is a better place to be on Sunday morning. Somebody say amen to that. Even though it's good right now, there comes a day, I don't know that day yet, I'm praying, right? There comes a day when it's time to go into the sanctuary for God. Did y'all notice what I just said? I said, you're going to go into, not for Kevin, not even for yourself. The first reason for entering the sanctuary is for God, right? But before you go into the sanctuary, before you get ready to worship, you got to be ready in your own self. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Hey, I don't know when the day is coming, but I believe the day is coming when God is going to open all this mess up, right? He's going to do it in his own time frame. And when he does, I hope you're going to be ready like I'm already. I'm ready for y'all to be here right now. That's how ready I am. Somebody say, I know, Reverend. I can tell. But the challenge in the moment is that when we're away like this, we become used to it. You know how habits are, right? Anybody having a habit that just won't go away? Well, listen to me. We've been doing this for almost 2 years for some of us, right? And it's good. It's getting good. It's real good. And reality is, one day it's going to be better. Oh, Reverend, what did you just say, Reverend? Yeah, it's going to be better. Because this is something I was thinking about just the last night. And that is that, remember, our forefathers had to worship in the woods. They didn't even have a building. They had to go and find a place in secret from the master. You know what I'm talking about. That's what they had to do. But this is the thing that blows my mind when I think about it. And I invite you to check the history on this. That many churches, immediately after the Civil War ended and we gained our freedom, that black churches, African-American churches begin to pop up all over the country. Check it out. Listen to this. 2 years after it was over, this church was started. Did y'all get that? 2 years, and don't miss this next point. 13 years later, they were building the basement on which we have right here today. Now, why did they go through all that? Because they knew there was a need for a place where the people of God could come together, fellowship together, worship together in the name of God. They like the woods, I guess. I don't know. Lions, tigers, y'all know the rest of that, right? But I believe they realize that there's something powerful about a place and a location where the people of God can come to worship. So I'm asking you right now in Jesus' name to get yourself ready. I can't give you a date. I can't tell you when, but I can tell you this, it's coming. Not because Reverend Wilson says so, because God is going to ordain it. That's what I'm looking forward to. But as I say all of that, I want you to look at the text for today. That first verse, the Bible says, Peter and John went to the temple one afternoon to take part in the 3 o'clock prayer service. Y'all, you didn't know that was in there, did you? 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they going to pray, right? You said, Reverend, they must have been real excited about Jesus. That's what it was. And they were going to pray. On their way to, we would say church, they had temple, synagogue, right? They were on their way to the synagogue to join in the prayer meeting. Oh, help us, Lord, right? The question of the hour is that when it's time to come, who's going to come? Peter and John were ready, and they went and look at what the next, listen to what I want to say right now. This is my greatest hope, that when the doors open, that not only will you come, but you'll bring somebody with you. My greatest hope is that not only, hear me now, this is so important. Not only will believers come, but those who don't even like God and don't even believe in God will come. That everybody, and I almost had said la-di-da-di, everybody will come running to the house of God. That's what I'm looking for, that even if you don't like God, you can come. Even if you don't even believe in God, you can come, because we want everybody to come into the house of God, because God is looking for everybody to come. Anybody get that? Look at the next verse. It said, as they approached the temple, a man lame from birth was being carried in. Each day he was put aside beside the temple gate, the one called Beautiful Gate, so he could beg from the people going into the temple. This is what I like about this. This man's friends knew and loved him. And listen to this. Don't miss this. They knew the best place to get your blessing was outside the temple. Don't miss this now. Don't miss this. They knew that if he was going to get the money he needed to survive for the rest of the week, that the best place to get the cash that he needed was right outside the temple gate. Amen? Anybody get that? He knew that there were generous people coming in. He knew there were people who would give him, they knew there were people who would give him what he need coming into to the temple. And here's what I want to say to you. What would it be like if people knew, no matter who they were, where they were, that this place right here, this body of believers who belong to this place, were those where the blessings of God can be found? Think about that for a minute. That the people will begin to know that this is a place where God is working. That this is a place that where you can get the things that God has for you. That when they talk about St. Paul AME in the city of Winchester, folk know, yeah, that's a church where the action is and where God is working. I don't know about you, but that's what I want to be a testimony to those around us, that this is the place to come where you want to see God do some stuff. Amen, somebody. His friends knew that he could get the money that he needed if he just hung out at the temple. And I'm praying right now, I'm believing right now, that one day that can happen for us, that folk will just be lining up to come because they know that what God has for them, they can find it right here on 428 North Loudoun Street. Amen, somebody. Y'all ain't feeling that. Yep, that's all right. I'm feeling it today. Because that's what I want it to be. That's what who I want us to become, that we are so dynamic in the things of God, so powerful in the things of God, that people will know that God is working here and that God has something for them right where St. Paul is located. Now, I need to say this. We ain't in no building right now. But you can still tell them where we are on the internet, right? I need you to hear. Come on, y'all know. I know how. Many of you know how to send your Facebook link, right? Your YouTube link. Come on, go through the list, right? When was the last time you sent your Facebook, YouTube link to a family member or friend? I'm just taking a moment to let that sink in for a minute. So often we keep it to ourselves when it ain't meant to be that way. We're meant to share the love of God, the message of Christ, with everybody that we can. So instead of hogging that link for yourself, send it to somebody else. What has happened to us, and I'm you give witness to this, that so often, because some of you have been doing that, there are a number of people who are connecting with us who don't even really know us at all. But they're coming online. They're watching us on Facebook simply because some of you have decided, I ain't going to keep this thing to myself. This thing is too good. This blessing is too great to keep it to myself. Listen, come on, send it out. It's all right. You say, Reverend, they might not like it. You don't even know yet. Send it out, right? Say, Reverend, I'm not sure. Listen, you are sure now because I just told you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, right? Send that link on out. Let people know that God is with us. God is for us, and that God is for them as well. Somebody ought to say amen to that again, because God, that's a fact about God. He loves us, and he wants to work in us. So that's my next point. Look at the third verse. This is something. This is so good, y'all. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for some money. Anybody seen that lately? I was in a debate with someone I love recently about those who are on the streets asking for money. And I don't know about you, but I've been debating myself and God with that for a minute. Right? Right? Well, the challenge there is, I'm going for the day, I'm going to leave it with you and God, right? Can I do that? But I want you to see this. This man was sitting at the gate, and don't miss this point. His friends or family put him there. Are y'all still listening? Because they know they couldn't help him, but they knew there were those who could. And listen to this. There were people at the, y'all not feeling me yet? There were people at the temple. He knew that. And he came there for some money, and you could tell it. He wanted some cash. Anybody? He didn't want no checks. When somebody's sitting out there in front of the church, you don't want to give them no check. You might not want to do that anyway, right? But he was looking for some money, right? But I love what Peter says next verse 4. Peter and John looked at him intently, and Peter said, "Look at us." Wow, y'all get that? Look at us. I pray that when people look at us, they will see more than a dollar sign. Didn't anybody feel that? Listen, you know this is true. So often people come because they know the money you got. Somebody say amen to that. They'll come looking for you not because of the God in you, but because of money in your bank account. Hallelujah, somebody. Anybody feel that? That so often people become enamored with you and like you not because of what you believe, but because of what you have. Anybody felt that? But I want you to hear this. Peter said, "Look upon us." And I want, this is what my prayer is for all of us, that when people look on us, they don't see a selfish Christian, but they see a person in love with God, ready to give away the things of God and the love of God. Somebody say amen to that too. Because that's real, that's real. But I like this. Listen to this. I love what God does. He was looking for cash. God had something better. You got to get that. Because so often people want our money, but in reality they need far more than that. Y'all not feeling that either, huh? They often want what we have, but the truth of the matter is there's something far more important that we have that we need to give away. Listen, this is the challenge to us. So often we have no problem with sharing our wealth, but we don't share our God. Anybody get that? We'll talk to people about this and that, or maybe the stock market, or maybe how the financial ramifications of doing this and that. But so often we miss sharing, simply talking about the goodness of God. That the reason you go to the stock market is not because of you, but because God gave you the money to put in the stock market. Hallelujah, somebody. That the reason you can do what you do with the money that you have, not because of you, but because of the God that's in you. Nobody feeling that either. Okay, I can see. Point I'm trying to make is, so often we want to give money, and we tend to forget that there's somebody far greater than the money that we have in the bank. And I ask you in the name of Jesus, hear me now. Come on, listen. Receive this for the sake of Christ, that after you give him the money, tell him about God. After you give him that little cash, tell him about Jesus, because the money will be gone in a minute. In a split second, that money, that cash will be gone. But if they get to know God, they can know him forever. Anybody feel that? I need you to understand that, because money is good. I'm not gonna be twisted about that. You need money. Anybody need money? Raise your hand. Anybody? Nobody here need money, but it's all right. I need money. But money, as good as it can get, is not enough. I need you to hear that, because just watch the billionaires on television. They're trying to get more and more. Have you noticed that? The millionaires getting more and more and more. And the amazing thing about it, you can see in their eyes that it's not enough if you're looking at them carefully enough. You can see that even though their wealth has expanded beyond anything they could ever spend. Did y'all get that? They can never spend. Their children, their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren can't even mess it up. But you can see, if you're listening, that it's not enough. Money is good. I'm not denying that. But you can't allow money to be the main reason you do what you do. I pray that when people look at us, they see more than a dollar sign. We must have more than money to offer the people who come our way. Did y'all hear that? Money is good. But I say it one more time, it's not enough. And then the man looked up at them eagerly, expecting some cash. That's what. Think about this now. In fact, I need to read this. He's been doing this for years, and he has found that those who speak to him usually give him some cash. Did y'all get that? That he was aware that those who acknowledge his presence, they usually are the ones that are going to give him something, right? Y'all seen that? Y'all done it yourselves, right? So he knew from sitting there for so many years, doing this for so many years, that Peter, he believed anyway, that they were about to lay something on him that he needed for the day, right? But it don't always work out that way. I like what Peter says next, y'all. Let's look at this. Verse 6. But Peter said, I don't have any silver or gold. Listen, Peter said, I'm broke. Anybody want to get that? Peter basically said, I don't have no money, man. I ain't got no money to give to you. Listen. But he says what next? I'll give you, this is the New Living Translation, I'll give you what I have. In the name of Jesus Christ of the Nazarene, get up and walk. I will give you what I have. This is the greatest challenge in the church. You ready? One of the greatest challenges in the church. And that is, most of us don't know what we have. Hello? Come on. Listen to this. Many of us don't know what God has put in us. We haven't even started to try. Listen, you will be amazed at what God has already invested in you if you will simply begin to talk to him about what is in you. The gifts, the talents, all the things that God has vested in you are available, but you have to be willing to let God use you. So often we don't have a clue of all that God has already designed us to do. Your design is unique from every other individual, but your design has been developed, if you will, by God for God's purposes, but you need to know what that means. Peter knew. Peter said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. I need to say this. That was not what the man was expecting. He was looking for some money, y'all. He was looking for cash. You know, his hand had probably already been elevated. Oh, because he's down, right? And they're looking down at him, so he probably had his hand out, right? But he had never heard anybody say that before. He'd been lame since birth. He's never heard anyone say, get up and walk. And he didn't want to walk in the moment. He wanted some money. But I need you to understand this. Even in our brokenness, God has an answer to it. The man was broken. The man's body was broken. But God had something for him that day that he was not aware was coming his way. He was looking for money. Let me say this. So often we're looking for cash when God has something far better. So often we're looking to get more things and more wealth. And I need you to hear this if you can for the moment, in this moment. That is that God has something for you far greater than the wealth that he wants that you have. I need to say this to you because it's all right to have money. Some of you think money is evil. It ain't evil. What does the Bible say? The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, right? Money is not evil. It's just a means of getting things done for your family and in other ways. But my friends, my brothers and my sisters, all of you who are listening to me today, there is something far greater than money. That is that which God has invested in you to use for his glory. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you begin to wonder, Lord, why have you made me for you? Many of us have been living this life for 50, 60, 70 years, right? And still haven't discovered why we're here. Hey, look, I'm telling you this. I pray you can hear this in the name of Christ. That is that God has so put something in you that can bless his body, the body of Christ. He has put something in you that can be used to minister to those who are in the community, but you had to step out in the power of God, in the anointing of God, so you can begin to see what God wants to do. So, Reverend, I don't know. Well, talk to me about it. Give me a call. Peter said, I'll give you what I have. And thing that began to happen was amazing. The man began to move in his healing. And the Bible says in verse 7, are you following me? Still with me? Don't leave yet. Okay, don't leave. This is verse 7. He said, then Peter took the lame man by the hand, right hand, and helped him up. And as he did, the man's feet and ankles were instantly healed and strengthened. So Peter reached down, the man got up. Peter reached down, don't miss this, man got up. I begin to think with my holy mind, I pray it was holy in the moment, that is that maybe people remember what happened to him when he was sinking in the water. You know what I mean? Can you use your Holy Ghost imagination and thinking about the fact that Peter had at one point was walking on the water to Jesus, and he got like most of us and started looking at all the crap around him, and he lost focus on God. And listen to this. He said three words, Lord, save me. Some of the time we spend a lot of words trying to get God to help us, and the thing we need to simply say is, Lord, save me. And the Bible says that Jesus reached down. Some of y'all went with us to Sight and Sound a while back. That was one of the most beautiful scenes in that presentation where the symbol of Jesus reaching down and pulling Peter up out of the water. Maybe, I don't know, I'm just speculating. Maybe Peter remembered that moment when God reached down and pulled him up. Hey, do you remember that day? The day that you were down and God reached down and pulled you up, that nobody believed you would ever be anything, but God, listen to me, reached down and pulled you up. That those who thought you would be in the mess you were in for the rest of your existence, but God reached down and pulled you up. Hey, you believe your own self that it would never get better. But what happened? God, y'all not feeling me in here either, but that's all right. God did it. God reached down in the name, in a powerful way, and pulled you out of your mess. The mess that looked like you would be in a mess the rest of your life. But God came up. And some of y'all had to yank you out of there. You know what I'm talking about. It was so bad. It was so dark. It was so ugly. The only way he could get you out was he had to pull you, snatch you out of there, right? But he did it. He came after you. He changed your life. He redeemed you. Somebody ought to get a praise on right now because you know that God did that for you, right? Somebody needs to stop and give God some glory. In fact, I like this next part. It says he jumped up, stood on his feet, began to walk, then walking, leaping, praising God. He went into the temple with them. This is crazy. What was your response to your healing? I need you to think about that for a moment, because so often we become used to the blessings of God that we sometimes don't acknowledge that blessing that's come because it's happening so much, right? And some of y'all, Reverend, I don't know nothing about no blessing. Well, you might need to check yourself on that. But the thing I want you to think about is when God healed you the last time, what was your response? What happened when God healed your soul? What happened when your brokenness was healed? What happened when God delivered you out of the mess that you were in? What did you do? What was your response to God when he did that just for you? I was listening to a program the other day, and a lady had been working for this businessman who was a millionaire for many years, and she was like an executive assistant, and she had been doing a great job of working for him, and he passed away. And the amazing thing that when he passed away, he left her some money. She's making $65,000 a year, right? Some of y'all say, $65,000, I'll take that. But she said with her $65,000, she was living from what? Y'all know what I'm going to say? Paycheck to paycheck, right? But he passed away, and she got a call from his wife saying, my husband has left you $1.2 million. Now, I don't know whether she got a praise on or not, but I know I would have. I probably been running and shouting for days, right? But she was blown away by the generosity that came her way. But friends, I need you to hear this. that when God does things like that, what is our response to God? Don't miss that. So maybe she thanked the family, thanked the wife, but I don't know the rest of the story. I didn't get the rest of the story, but I know that she got that awesome gift. You've gotten a gift far greater than that. God saved your life. God saved your soul. God bless your family. Look at it. Stop looking at this stuff, y'all. So often we look at you're like a person who only sees through a dark glass. Every now and then, if you look for a minute, you'll see a reason to praise and glorify God and lift his name. It says the man lost it. You ever lose it? He could not contain himself. I mean, you think about it. He had never walked before. He had never been able to leap before. Leap, you must be out of your mind, right? He was completely blown away. He literally went off. Y'all, you can't see it anymore? Think about it. He had never walked. Listen, don't miss this. He had never leaped, but he knew how to worship and praise. Did y'all get that? Don't miss that. He couldn't walk, but he knew what to do when God blessed him. Y'all feel that yet? He knew that something had happened to him that was amazing, and it was his actions to that presented to us how we are to act when God blesses us. When it's that good, when it's that great, you better tell God something about it, right? So he didn't know how to walk, didn't know how to lead, but he knew how to worship God. Hallelujah, somebody. You say, Reverend, I'm down right now, but do you know how to worship? Say, Reverend, I ain't making it right now, but do you know how to worship God anyway? Say, Reverend, I don't have much money in the bank. All right, but do you know how to worship God? All I'm trying to say is that when we learn to worship God in our broken place, God can work in our broken place to bring us out of it. Right? Come on, somebody. Give God the praise. Somebody out there, give God the glory, because he just told you something that you needed to hear right now, that you have spent yourself time in a pity party instead of a praise party. Hallelujah, somebody. Come on, give him praise. Bless his name. He did it. He brought you out. He's kept you. You ought to give him praise. Glory to his name. That brother began to take off into the temple of God. He was flying. I don't know if you can see what I can see. He was flying high, man. Check him out. He was in it. Are you in it? He was fired up, y'all. Somebody needs to start praising God right now. I don't know who you are. You said, no, I ain't going to do it, Reverend. Go ahead, do it. So, Reverend, that ain't me. Shucks. Well, all God done for you, better get it on right now. Come on. You better go ahead and do it right now. I'm talking to you. Yes, you. You need to go ahead and give God praise, because if you look at what's happening in your life, just the last year alone, that's a reason to acknowledge the goodness and the blessings of God. Go ahead and do it right now. I'll give you a minute. You got a minute. Take it. Take the minute. I don't know if you'll have a minute later on, but you got one right now. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. You know what God has done for you. You know how far God has brought you. You have seen the power of God in your life. When all that happened, he went into the temple. Did you get that? He said, this is so awesome. He went from sitting outside, broken and destroyed, to standing up and leaping into the sanctuary. That takes you to what I'm talking about right now, which is one day God's going to do it. One day God's going to open it up. One day God's going to work in a mighty way. And what you're going to need to do, some of y'all are going to need to leap. Some of y'all can't leap. That's okay. But some of y'all are going to need to come running, right? Some of y'all are going to say, Lord, you kept me through COVID for 2 years. I'm coming in. You're going to need to say, Lord, the enemy tried to destroy me, but I'm coming in, right? Oh, Lord, have mercy. You have shown me your favor. You've shown me your grace, but I'm coming back. I'm coming in because I want to worship you. I want to bless your name. And I'm telling you right now that when the doors of God open up, it's going to be a time to give God praise and give God glory. I hope you're ready for it because it's coming. He is worthy. He is our God. He's going to get it done. In Jesus' name, amen. I got to stop right there. Give God a hand of praise because you know it's true. Give God the glory because he did it. And the day is coming when he'll bring us all together to praise him, to glorify him, and to bless his name. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you have kept us. And Lord, I can't wait for the day. Can't wait for the day you open the doors for everybody. That's anybody can come in and worship you. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that we all in this hour in this moment realize that yes, we can praise where we are. But praise reaches a whole new dynamic in the sanctuary with the fellow, with other believers. And God, we need it. We need you. So we ask right now in Jesus' name that you would open the doors. You would help us in Jesus' name to run to the sanctuary when the doors are open. I pray in Jesus' name that you will have so blessed us that we cannot even contain ourselves, that we will be so excited about you that nothing can keep us from running into your sanctuary. God, we pray that for every child of God that's listening right now. We pray that in Jesus' name that all of us will realize that the moment is coming when we come together to worship you. Now, Father, I pray you'll touch somebody who needs to be healed right now. I pray in Jesus' name that in the name of Jesus the Nazarene that you'll heal somebody right now. God, I pray in Jesus' name that you'll begin to work in the heart of somebody right now who has been away from you, Father. I pray in Jesus' name that you will do a mighty, powerful work for your glory, dear God. Do it right now. We agree together as your sons and daughters that you can touch and you can change and you can bless and you can do mighty works right now. And so we ask you in Jesus' name to show forth your mighty hand. Have your way, God. We yield to you. We surrender to you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. The only name that's strong enough. The only name that's powerful enough to make this happen. We ask it in his name. Amen. All right, you've got what you need. If you accept it. You got what you need. It's your turn. Maybe you don't even know God. You don't even like him that much. As I already said, he loves you more than you can ever begin to imagine. The Bible tells us that God gave his son for you, and he loved you. And because he loved you, he did that. And all you have to do is believe on his name. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. You shall be saved. So believe on him today. Trust in him today. And I guarantee you, this is a guarantee that I can't give it because of Kevin. I give it because of the power of the Spirit of God. That is, if you believe in him, you believe in him, he can change everything. So I invite you to give your heart to him, give your life to him, and watch him work in your life. If you need to run back to your church, okay, if you need to go back to your fellowship, do it. Don't wait. Call the pastor and tell him you're on your way the next time Sunday. Or you can't go in, you can at least make a call, right? And you can call me too. You can call me. I'm available. And I think you know the numbers by now. I'll give you the church number, 540-532-9593. You got it, right? I know you got it. Okay. Call us. Reach out to us. Because we want you to know that this is a fellowship of believers. That's all about God. And anybody is welcome. All right? Amen, amen. My final comment to you is understand that when God brings a blessing, take a moment to praise. Take a moment to worship. Because he is worthy, right? He's worthy. Amen, amen. Listen, I'm going to take a moment as we end our time together to pray for our country. It's still not good. I've heard, and I'm happy that COVID is going down. I hope you've heard that. It's happening. But our leaders have not changed. It's still just as messed up. Let's pray. Let's agree together that God would help them to begin to compromise, that he would help them to cross over the political and the ideology barriers, that they can do some work for us. Because we pay them. Y'all know we pay them. And so because we pay them, they need to be working for us. But I think what needs to happen is for us to pray for them that they'll stop fighting and start getting the work for the people done. That's my prayer. That's my hope for them. But let's just take a moment to pray for them in D.C. and believing God can help them. So let's pray. God, we come to you knowing, Father, that the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. We know you can handle the king's heart. We know you can handle the leaders of our country's hearts. We know you can change and move them in a direction that would be good for everybody that lives on this side in this place called America. And so we ask you in Jesus' name to begin to work in them day by day, help them to understand that the foolishness and the anger and the divisiveness that is happening on a daily basis is not for the betterment of the country. Open their eyes and help them to see that their ideology, if it is in hindrance to accomplishing the work of the nation, that is not good. So I pray in Jesus' name that you awaken them to the reality of what is good and right. And I pray that you'll use those who are believers in the midst of the Congress, in the midst of the Senate, and in the midst of the White House who believe in Jesus. I pray you'll anoint them that they might be able to share a word that will convince and persuade those who are engaged in leadership that they need to move in a better direction. Father, use the Christians engaged in these environments and help them to stand with boldness in your power for the glory of Christ. God, we need this. We've been waiting, but we ain't going to stop waiting until you say so, because your timing is not ours, Father. And we just place all of this before you in your hand, in your awesome care. I ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. All right. Listen, it's been great hooking up with you. Again, I said something that it was very important. That is, you need to send your Facebook. We'll have the message, the service will be on Facebook. It'll be on YouTube. Go get it. I think it will be on there by this afternoon or tomorrow, right? By tomorrow, it'll be there. Send it to somebody. You can text it. I don't know if you can email it. I guess you can email it too, right? Text it, email it, send it to somebody. Somebody might need to hear the word, right? They might need to hear that to help them to be a better them. I know that's not good English, but it's good for me, right? Do that. Send it out. And I believe that if you do, you'll be amazed at what God will do. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for being with us today. Keep praying for us here who serve every Sunday. Pray for us. Keep us lifted before the Lord, because we need prayer, man. I tell you, we need prayer to continue to do this work for God. And pray for each other, right? Don't forget that. Every now and then, call out the fellow members of St. Paul and pray for those who join us every week who don't belong to us yet. Yet. You're always welcome, though. You can become a part of us anytime. Just reach out to us. But let's go to God for our benediction. Enough has been said. Let's go to God. The grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and rule with each of us now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let the people of God say amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Have a blessed week in the Lord. And hey, don't forget to be back next Sunday, same time, same seat at your house. In Jesus' name, God bless you.